singularity.
My name is Nicola, aka Socrates, and you're watching Singularity FM, the place where we interview the future. If you guys enjoy this show, you can help me make it better in two ways. One, you can go on iTunes and write a brief review. And two, you can come to singularityweblog.com and make a donation. Today, my guest on the show is Marek Rosa. Marek is founder and CEO of Keen Software, which is an independent video game development studio. After the success of his game titles such as Space Engineers, Marek founded and personally funded GoodAI with $10 million and was finally able to pursue his lifelong dream of building general artificial intelligence. Most recently, Marek launched the General AI Challenge with a fund of $5 million, and he wrote a very interesting and descriptive guest blog post on singularityweblog.com that I recommend our viewers and listeners check out for sure. So, without further ado, welcome, Marek.
Hello, Nicola.
So, Marek, if you were to introduce yourself in a couple of sentences, how would you do that yourself? Who is Marek Rosa?
I started as a programmer, and that was my passion, and also science and technology and future and sci-fi, all those things. And like one of the driving forces in me is like curiosity. Like I want to know why things work, they work, and or what is like behind the horizon that we can see and so on. And I'm just like going after this goal, or like I'm trying to satisfy one little piece of curiosity after another. And you introduced me nicely. And yeah, that's it. Like we are working here at GoodAI on developing general AI, or getting closer to general AI, because we believe that it's a tool like a leverage that can basically leverage every other tool or help us to actually get to either singularity or better futures and to better understand the universe. So we are working on general AI.
That's fascinating work, and of course the reason why you're here on my show. But before we get there, let us talk a little bit about the journey that you had to be able to afford to invest $10 million in artificial general intelligence. So tell us first about how you got interested in AI and or gaming, and which one was your first love and why?
When I was 14 or 15, I started to programming. And I started at that age because before that I didn't have computer at home, so I couldn't do programming. So I was just reading books and, you know, doing that stuff. So when I started programming, one of the first things was probably AI that got me interested, because I realized that I want to create some kind of bot or robot or something like this that can communicate with me, that can do things for me, and so on. And I realized that if we automate intelligence, we would be able to scale it up basically infinitely and use it for whatever we need. So basically, instead of me trying to invent spaceships or medicine for cancer or medicine for like long life or anything like this, I can actually build AI, and then the AI will invent all these other things. So that's why I think it's a leverage. And so this was the main reason, and basically it stays like that, like it didn't change, only the details change. And regarding the gaming, I think I started maybe in parallel, but the first games that I was making were just some simple things. And back then, because it's 20 years ago basically, I was considering two career paths. One was that I will be working on AI, you know, like a scientist or in academia or something like this. And the other was that I will be making games and make some money, and then I can actually fund my own AI research and be more independent and so on. Or there was maybe even other route, and this would be that I would start with AI and business as first thing, and then, you know, do something next. But the viability of AI making some money 20 years ago didn't look promising to me. The game did seem more promising to me, and also At that age, I was more willing to work on games because it was just fascinating. So I started with the games first and put AI just on some, like, you know, somewhere in the backside of my brain. And so I was working on games and also other things, like other programming projects. And a couple of years ago, finally, after some learning, you know, and like failures and things like that, finally, we made Space Engineers game, and this became successful. And from there, I realized, like, okay, I hit that point, you know, that I was just dreaming about before that I can independently start GoodAI and start focusing on general AI on a full time, which I'm still not 100% full time on GoodAI. I'm still managing the gaming side, gaming company a little bit, but also this will change. Actually, quite soon, because we hired CEO for King Software House. So in a couple of months, I think I will be just a mentor or some kind of chairman for the gaming company, and then I will really spend 100% of my time on general AI.
Fantastic. So AI kind of was probably your first love, but you chose to take the practical route of making money and developing games, which was another passion of yours. But if you were to share with us, what's your ultimate motivation or ultimate main goal? Just like you asked me, what do you want before we started the recording? You asked me, what is your goal? What are you trying to do with Singularity Weblog? So let me send this back at you. What's your ultimate motivation or main goal?
Basically, we have this in the mission statement of GoodAI, and it's... help humanity and understand the universe. And in order to do these two things, we need to build general AI. Because with general AI, it will be much more easier, much more productive or effective, much more cheaper to actually do these two other things. So I'm not saying like I'm some like total altruist that and I'm like thinking about helping humanity all the time. But if I think about this, that I have some kind of mission on this in this world, or like, you know, some purpose, I would say that that's one of the part, but there is also the other very important, and it is understanding the universe. And again, it's just two words, but you can see much more behind these two words, because understand the universe also means be able to live like preferably forever, or to see what is actually, how did this universe came to life, you know, and what is this universe? How does it work? How does it run? And if there is some end or if there is not, and basically just understand all these things much more. And maybe other way how to put this also is that to maximize our future options so that we are not closing them by, for example, dying, or we are not closing them by not having AI, but actually I want to be opening up our future options, maximizing them. And so this is another way how to put this.
Mm-hmm. If you were to paint that not logically as you just did, but as a picture, imagine like a surrealistic or impressionistic picture which expresses the vision that you have for the future or the dream that you have of the future, how is that going to look like?
I think it will be machines or people connected with machines, but at that point it will not be a difference. And basically optimizing the science, research, engineering, like harvesting of the resources and exploration and exploitation of this universe in order to either like maximize these future options or kind of like work on this curiosity or like discover novel and novel things and then exploit them and so on. And I'm thinking about these like some machines that are like exploring, exploiting, and still working on some kind of recursive self-improvement. And my picture is like this. So, and these machines, they can be on different scales and also different sizes, different types, and anything like this. And working on such a vast scale that's even hard to imagine for me, like, you know, the usual singularity examples where you have entire planet as a huge computer, not like a
computronium.
Computronium.
Extracting all the solar energy of the star.
Yeah. Not basically having the matter in a stupid form as it is like today, but having it in something that's actually doing some computation, some intelligent computation, and solving some tasks or discovering things and so on. So basically turning the universe into this kind of machine.
We'll come back to that in a second, but let me share with you this. So all of our motivation comes not only from pleasure and hopes and dreams, but also from pain and fears. So let me flip the other side of the coin. You just shared your biggest dream with us. Is there something that you would call your biggest fear, whether it's personally for you or collectively for us as a civilization?
This is a good point, because actually I'm using, even for myself, both motivations, like positive and negative. And I'm not only motivated by the positive things, like things that we can achieve and so on, but also things that we can lose, you know, if we don't do something, or things like bad things that can happen to us. And so, for example, one of these scary things for me is that I will die before we get to AGI or singularity or something like this, because I think it will be shame, basically, because, you know, like it's such a low probability that we happen to be in this world in this century, you know, where we actually have a good chance of getting to AGI and singularity. And if you die just a couple of years before that, it's like, it's shame, in my opinion. So I don't want this to happen. And it's one of the driving forces that's like pushing me faster and faster forward, that it can be just a little thing, you know, and you die and then everything is like closed for you. So for example, this is one of the things. And but again, it's not like I'm paralyzed by this, you know, by being scared or something like this. It's more like that it's really pushing me forward. And actually it all helped me also in business, in game development, where we were not in super comfortable situation, because when you are super comfortable, you have everything you need. It's like you are kind of not lazy, but you know, like you are okay. And on the other side, if you know that you have money in the bank only for, let's say, 6 months, 12 months, and you need to pay people and all these things, and you have only one chance of success, then you need to invest all your energy just to the thing. And I think this is very good. So maybe this will sound strange to some people, but I'm actually trying to put myself under some kind of stress even now, when some people can say like, okay, like your company, it's running well, you know, and all these things. But if everything will be too easy for me, then I could lose a little bit of this drive, mm-hmm. prioritization and all these things. So yes, I or maybe totally different angle how to put this is that if I imagine some possible scenarios or possible futures, and I see one where we can have this great, all these great things, and there is another where we lost it, you know, we didn't manage it in the right way, then I want to avoid this bad scenario as much as possible. And basically, I am also visualizing this scenario in my head as something to avoid, like totally avoid. So I'm using negative reinforcement on myself quite a lot.
Yeah. You know, by the way, your fear that you may die before the singularity and so on, I don't know if you're familiar with it, but Kevin Kelly coined the, I think it's called Mays-Garrow Law, which is basically the statement that most favorable predictions about future technology will fall within the Mays-Garrow point, which is defined as the latest possible date a prediction can come through and still remain within the lifetime of the person who's making the prediction. So Kevin Kelly noticed that most people who make predictions about the future, you know, always push off that prediction as late as possible, but not beyond of their expected death, usually right about a little bit before that, so that luckily for themselves, they would actually witness it. And, you know, that's, of course, a warning in a way to kind of push forward our own biases that we would be lucky enough to witness those changes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's a very nice saying. Yeah, makes sense.
Okay, so let's talk about good AI. Now, first of all, let's get on with some of the specifics. How many people do you have in your team currently, and where are you located?
So there is about 20 people in the company. Most of them are researchers or engineers and programmers. And we are based in Prague, in Czech Republic. And GoodAI started about 3 years ago. But we started to talk about the company publicly only about 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I see. And now, you said that you did about a $10 million personal investment to launch the company. So where is that money spent? What's kind of the budgeting for? Is it for salaries of the people you have hired? Do you have an R&D lab and so on?
Yes, yes, it's mostly for salaries or like people costs, and maybe the office costs also some money, but it's far less than the people, and some money goes to conferences, you know, and this kind of stuff. Yeah, mostly to people at this moment, and I'm expecting that in the future we'll actually need to pay much more for the hardware.
Yeah, that's the reason why I'm asking, because I recently interviewed another company which has a very similar name to yours, by the way, called Kindred AI, which is a Canadian company, and they have a considerable budget for hardware, given the fact that they're trying to build human-level embodied intelligence, which is to say robots with human capabilities. So I'm thinking that as you get better in what you do, you would have to move out of software into hardware more and more, and therefore the budgeting prioritization may actually start shifting.
Yes, 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 that's possible. I'm like keeping all these things open, and also the funding and the way how I'm like still adding the money basically to this budget is that I wanted to have a really long runway for the period where we don't have any kind of income, or where it's actually super hard to predict, you know, if the breakthrough will come in a year or 5 years or 10 years or something like this. So on the other side, like having a too long runway again can be double-edged sword.
Yeah, you know? Yeah.
Like, okay, I have so much time, I don't need to really push myself. So
right.
For this reason, we are creating all these, and mostly me, all these other like methods how to push ourselves and focus also on the short-term goals, mm-hmm. and not be like just some guys dreaming about AGI or something like this, but really have some very short-term and very specific goals.
Yeah, I will come back to your milestones in a second. I still want to lay out a little better the general macro level picture and sort of the strategic positioning and the thinking behind it, yeah, if I may. So, because, you know, if you're a venture capitalist, one of the first questions that they would ask is like, okay, what's the exit strategy? In other words, you're putting $10 million. That's a lot of money. You're taking a big personal risk. They would say, what's the exit strategy? How do you make that money back?
Like in the long term, the exit strategy is singularity and you know, and immortality and all these things, which is, I think, much more valuable than just $10 million. Actually, I think it's more valuable than like billions of dollars. And so that's the exit strategy, if you can call this exit. And but I think we'll be able to make money even in short term, like in years. We started a sister company called GoodAI Business, and in there we are applying some of our prototypes. And the thing is that as even today, the AI is still limited. You know, like it's not a human level AI, so it has some capabilities, but also many limitations when you compare it to the way humans are solving tasks or humans are learning. And so there are some applications or some use cases where you can use AI today without, like you can use it, you know, because there are some low-hanging fruits and so on. But there are still many things that are just like out of the reach of today AI. Or maybe yes, but you need a lot of human engineering to actually have useful AI in that use case. So, and as we were moving and upgrading our AI prototypes and getting it, you know, with better capabilities, and less these limitations, we will be applying it at our customers, and this can be revenue. And I think in the beginning, the revenue will not be any crazy, because there will be like certain amount of value that the AI can add to customers' business. But as we will go later and later, the AI will be increasing its capabilities, and then the value that it adds to the customer can be like basically exponential. So, and then I think it can make like a lot of money, basically. I think more money than we will actually need.
Mm-hmm. By the way, another person who does work very similar to what you do and uses the same kind of funding model, that is to say, he makes money with narrow AI applications, which he then reinvests in developing general AI applications. And his name is Peter Voss, if you're interested. I've interviewed him a couple of times on my show.
Peter
is a very fascinating individual too. So now let's talk about the actual meat of the matter, the nitty-gritty, all the details of how we're going to make this happen. So first of all, though, we have to define the terms, right? Terms which are easily thrown around all the time. And my impression after doing over 200 of these interviews is that everyone has a bit of a different flavor to the term. So quite often people who argue actually talk besides each other because they have different meaning of the term. So I want to be very specific and define them. So let's start first with intelligence. Because if we're talking about artificial intelligence, first we have to figure out what intelligence is on its own. So what's intelligence for Marek?
One of the definitions that we use is that intelligence is a tool for searching for solutions to problems. And so it's like a search, you know, in some space of possible hypothetical solutions to some problems. And what is intelligent about this is how you organize this search, you know, how you make it more efficient than just brute force through all the possible solutions, but how you organize it in a way that is getting, let's say, exponentially and exponentially better at efficiency of learning to solve or solving those problems. And I can go in much more detail, but this is the main definition that we use. And yeah.
So, okay. So then, let's see. Where does the artificial part in artificial intelligence come in at, and how? Mm-hmm. In other words, what does that stand for? What does it mean? How do we define it?
Artificial means for me only that it's something created by people, and but other than that, it's also still just a natural process of this universe, you know. So it's like this universe or the evolution created us through some very, very long process. Luckily it was gradual, you know, so it's one new invention building on top of the previous inventions and so on, so it's getting more efficient, like with every, let's say, iteration. And now we are building artificial intelligences. And when we will really build artificial intelligence, like real AI, you know, something that's comparable to the way humans are learning and solving, then this will take over in the following intelligent search. Or maybe another way, or like analogy that I'm using, is that the universe is doing some kind of search where it's searching for better for structures that are better at searching for better structures and so on. You know, so it started all with Big Bang and just some, let's say, particles. Again, this is simplification. Then it evolved to a structures like galaxies and planets and this planet, you know, with life, some very simple life, more complex life, intelligent life, people, society, and in a few years or decades, AGI. And this search will just continue, you know. And we're always searching for structures that are better at searching, more efficient, and so on.
Let me push back a little bit here on that thesis, though, because that's a very teleological thesis and comes very much straight out of Ray Kurzweil's book, The Singularity is Near, where he talks about the trend from lower level intelligence to higher level intelligence, and until the ultimate moment where, as you put it previously, we don't have any more dumb matter, but it's all smart matter. And as he calls it, the universe wakes up. And that's supposedly the direction of evolution. But I would say that's only one direction, perhaps, of the evolution, because evolution doesn't have a direction. It has directions, many of them. Some of those directions take us through higher intelligences and more intelligence. Some take us exactly the other way around. So, for example, in biology, we have organisms who have de-evolved intelligence. Because intelligence comes at a very high price. You need to have a certain amount of neuroprocessing matter, like our brains, which is very expensive. It takes maybe 40% of our calories. It requires very specific conditions. And it creates very narrow range of survivability of the organism. And yet other organisms which have de-evolved that have higher adaptability and higher survivability, therefore, because their range is expanded. They require less nutrition. They're more capable and able to adapt to the environment. So I'd say evolution moves both ways, always. And it's like a cone of possibilities, not a single one. And if you take it to the cosmic level, we have, as you said, the formation of the planets and the stars, but we have the opposite formation too, or deformation of the explosion of supernovas, right? So we have the two directions constantly going against each other, extropy and entropy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. And I would maybe add that this search is like search without objectives, so, or without one specific objective or like a target. That
exactly.
I'm not saying that the evolution is going to one very specific point. I think it's just like moving according to some fitness, you know. So if it's better to be stronger to survive in some environment, then it will evolve in stronger. If it is better to be smarter, then it will evolve in smarter, and so on. Of course, it's very local, you know, like there are some local maxima.
Yeah, but is it better to be smarter? Let me give you another example. So we are the smartest species on our planet, right? Imagine the, and you said intelligence is the best tool for optimization and certain problems. And the biggest problem of our species is, of course, survivability, right? And you said that one of the goals is to avoid death, achieve immortality, populate the universe or spread throughout the universe, which of course are all things that are going to improve our survivability. But is intelligence really helpful? Let me give you an example. Take a cockroach, a rat, and a university level professor like Albert Einstein, and send them to a desert island somewhere in the middle of nowhere. Go later, 6 months or 12 months or 18 months later, who do you think has the best chance of survival and adaptation? Einstein, the most intelligent guy, or the rat or the cockroach?
That's a good question, and it depends on the environment, you know, local environment and the timing, because in this setting that you said, maybe the rat or the cockroach will survive, but if you give it more time or you change the environment a little bit, then the Einstein will have more chances, because maybe Einstein will find a crashed airplane with supplies and everything and will, you know, be very happy, and he will knew how to use that supplies, and where the rat will not be able to open the lock to the airplane or something like this, you know. So, or maybe another way, if we go on a larger time scale, rats and cockroaches and all these simpler life forms could be living on these planets for millions of years, maybe even another billion or so, but then some asteroid will just crash to the planet and kill them all. Whereas we, with our intelligence, will be already way off from this planet, like will not be here anymore, or maybe, you know, like will be much more like distributed through the universe. So just one planet will not matter that much, or will be actually able to stop the asteroid and all these things. So I think I don't have like a answer that will tell you that intelligence is winner all the time, because it is not.
It is not. That's precisely my point. Yeah.
Yeah, but I think it's just about increasing the chance that you can adapt and solve some new and unseen problems. And that is a better tool with higher chance. But again, there can be a situation where it can actually work against you, like that experiment with the flies, you know, where there were some flies that had higher intelligence, but also higher consumption of energy. And then there were flies with, you know, some stupid flies. And basically, when you played with the environment, like there was less food, the smart flies had much more problems than the stupid flies. So again, it very much depends on the environment. But if I had to bet on something, I would rather bet on intelligence, you know, with this survivability and long-term survivability, and basically being able to adapt to new problems, you know, problems that you never like experienced before, that with intelligence, you have higher chances of solving them. It doesn't need to work perfectly. Like, there is no guarantee, you know, that's another good thing. It's still just approximations. But I would rather be intelligent and use intelligence to solve problems than not be intelligent.
I agree. I would rather be more intelligent rather than less myself too. But my point was here that we shouldn't underestimate. And I have moved from a sort of a teleological linear thinking and now have embraced a little bit more of a mixed back mosaic thinking. So let me give you another example. Our planet, we often say, is dominated by humans. But what we forget is that it's actually not dominated by humans. It's dominated by bacteria. And bacteria doesn't have any intelligence, and yet it's evolving much faster than we can even beat it up with our antibiotics, etc., etc. And it doesn't have intelligence to do that. It simply does it by a process of evolution, which lacks intelligence at the individual level, but apparently is smart enough at the species level to adapt and even defeat our best tools that our intelligence can come up with. And let's say if we have a nuclear war today, chances are bacteria, cockroaches, and rats would have much better chances of survival than humanity does. Or if we have a huge asteroid impact tomorrow, like a killer asteroid or a killer volcanic eruption or something like that, those are the ones that are more likely to survive. At least I would bet more on that, on those, even though I personally prefer always to have more intelligence.
So
I'm just trying to be the devil's advocate here and undermine some of those assumptions, if I may.
But still, the thing is that even with better intelligence, you can be solving some problems and only see up to certain, you know, like future or a certain horizon, and your actions that are good for the next year can be actually devastating for the following years and so on. So
just like we are doing right now with our intelligence with global warming.
So it's not 100% guaranteed thing, but you know, and as you said, with this like intelligence on the species level, not on the individual, but on the species level, that's also part of it, you know, that even the humanity has some kind of abstract intelligence, let's say bigger than just one individual. Same thing we can say about evolution. If you look on the entire process, it's not very intelligent, but there is some learning, you know, there is some adaptation, so some kind of intelligence, and it works. But it can also work on much smaller time scale and faster, and use better methods how to evaluate the futures, you know, and prepare for these futures and so on. And that's what we are doing with that human kind of intelligence.
Yeah. Okay. And I totally agree, by the way, with Socrates, who says better Socrates unsatisfied than a pig satisfied. So yes, I would also choose more rather than less intelligence myself. Anyway. Let's talk about how you're going to accomplish those goals that you shared with us. So we discussed what is intelligence and what is artificial intelligence. Now, the question is, how do we build that, especially when it's not narrow AI, but it's general AI, as you explicitly say in your statement. And then there's one more even harder step than that, which is taking the general AI and making it actually good, which is not necessarily self-obvious, I think. And it's the maybe even harder than creating the general AI, or that's often referred to as the control problem or the alignment value alignment issue. So let's take that and break it into steps. First of all, how do you plan to build AGI?
Okay, so the way we are planning to do it, or that we are doing it, there are different angles that I can start with. One of them is that we studied how different ways how to do general AI, how to approach general AI, which ended up with having few roadmaps of, and the roadmap is like, we are here, we need to get to human level AGI, so let's define what is human level AGI. Let's say it's AI that has repertoire of problem solving skills similar to a human, like a normal human, and then how to get there and solve one milestone after another. And we have multiple roadmaps in our team, but the common shared paradigm is gradual learning. And that's basically, some people may call it continuous learning, incremental learning, maybe transfer learning. But basically the principle is that you build new skills on top of previous skills, or you reuse previously acquired skills to acquire new skills. So basically you're gradually getting better and better at learning, at problem solving, and so on. And so this is one part of the answer. It's gradual learning, and we are working on this. Even the AI challenge is about this. And the other part is guided learning, and this gets us closer to your second question about how to make the AI actually good. So if we will have AI that can gradually build one skill or acquire one skill after another and use these acquired skills to acquire new skills more efficiently, then we create a curriculum, you know, some learning tasks, like many of them, and we will start training the AI on this curriculum. And this curriculum must be kind of like a good curriculum. So there must be tasks that will actually positively bias the AI to have beneficial and safe behavior towards us.
So what and kind of task can do that?
We will start with very simple tasks, just like now, you know, we are basically playing with symbols and so on. So it's nothing that I would say this is human level AI. It's just, you know, the beginning. But at, later and later, as the AI will be, or when the architecture, this AGI architecture that we are building will be much more strong or powerful, then there will be learning tasks that will be similar to what children are being told or, you know, educated. So basically, I would say it will go through some kind of kindergarten, school, similar to people. And probably it will not be one-to-one mapping, but something very similar, maybe in similar order. Depends on what kind of biases we will have in the architecture and then in the curriculum. But again, the point is that first start training some simple task, and then the other task are reusing the skills or the knowledge gained in the previous task, and it's like snowballing basically. And as you are acquiring more and more skills, you are able to learn new skills much more efficiently. And the AI could start learning the skills, or would start learning the skills in a similar manner as people, you know, just by reading books, interacting with other people or other AIs and so on. And here we will need to bias the AI to be good, which means that there will need to be some tasks that will positively bias the AI to be good for us. So one of the ideas is that, for example, we can show with books or stories where there is some positive human character, probably not Bible.
I hope not. There is not much positive for me in the Bible, but hey, that's just me.
And but you know, we can find some good books on this showing like good characters, and then we'll bias the AI to take these positive human characters as a role model. And
I would venture to suggest ancient Greek and Roman philosophy. That's my favorite. Socrates, Seneca, Cicero, Marcus Aurelius.
Yeah. So this is the plan. And the last part of the answer is that we named the company GoodAI. So we, by the definition, cannot create not good AI, you know. So like you can be assured that our AI will be good.
So wouldn't that be some kind of crazy irony? if the good AI company came up with the bad AI, and how do you prevent that from happening? What's the, like, do you have a guarantee? Money back or otherwise? Life back guarantee?
I think that there cannot be 100% guarantee. It's just about lowering the probability that we or someone else will create bad AI to a minimum, or to a probability that is way lower than the probability that without doing the AI we will be in a worse situation. So again, it's like weighting these two things, that if we do AI, if we don't do AI, there is some chance that something bad will happen to the humanity and so on. And then again, there is another scenario, we create AI and there is some chance that the AI will go crazy and destroy humanity. And we need to lower this probability to a number that which is much, much, much lower than the probability that without doing AI, we can do.
What is an acceptable number for Marek? Let's say you're developing an AGI and you have it 70% chances of being good and 30% chances of being bad. Are you going to launch it publicly?
No. I think the probability must be like, just like, for example, when you sit to a car and, drive home or something like that, you are not thinking that, okay, the probability of me killing myself is this or this. It's like, it never happened to you, that you crashed on your way home, probably or hopefully. And so you are not even considering it. So if I have to put this in an emotional, description, I would use an image, something like this, because the numbers can be complicated. And even calculating these numbers, if everything is just some approximation or estimation, it's very hard. So I don't have maybe satisfactory answer to this, but I would say that the measurement of the probability must be so low that the possibility that it will go wrong will be almost impossible. Like for all practical purposes, it will be almost zero. It will not be zero, but it will be almost zero.
So 99.99999 something.
Yeah, and then very, very, I think very, very many nines at the end.
Because, I mean, there's a number of issues there in terms of the commercial sort of impetus that, companies want to launch earlier and earlier products so that they can start generate cash flow. Hopefully you don't have that kind of pressure because you have already a successful source of revenue. But the other thing is something that you mentioned previously in terms of the reinforced learning one-on-one from a human, because we know some humans will kill all of us today if they could. Or some humans just go crazy, or some humans just do stupid stuff all the time. And most humans do stupid stuff all the time, even the smartest of us in some of their areas. Like Einstein was notorious, the prototype of the distracted professor. So how do we prevent that issue? If the AI is learning from the wrong person, or even if it's the right person, but it's at the wrong time, because let's say you have a good person who has problems at home with his family relationship or at work or with his bank account or with his children or something, and gets totally upset or emotionally unstable. And then the AI starts emulating that kind of behavior.
Mm-hmm. So since we plan to teach the AI through the curriculum must be good. And so I don't think, or in the first stages, I don't think the AI will be learning from the people or just by listening to normal people, what they want to teach it. I think in the beginning, the AI will learn just from this curriculum, and this curriculum will be designed in a way that is beneficial and safe, and must be so. So when later someone will try to retrain the AI to do some bad stuff, the AI will already be biased to kind of like ignore this command. So for example, if I ask you if you want to kill 10 people, just for fun, I'm assuming that based on your like biases that you have right now in you, like positive biases, basically, you will say, no, thank you, I don't want to kill 10 people. So and that's it. Like nobody can force you. I mean, probably someone could do it, some hack or something like this, but you would be really trying to do everything in your power to not let someone else bias you in a way that killing 10 people is something you actually want to do. So you will be preventing all these things, all these attempts, to to maybe change your perception of what is a human.
Or yeah, and that's where the idea of the school for AI comes in, because I've been very fortunate to have good mentors in my life and to have had good schooling and stress on ethics and about what's right and wrong. And therefore, I emulate good examples and I'm inspired by good examples. So hopefully, and as you said, the idea behind School of AI is precisely that. And that's where the curriculum is so important. But talk to me about the other pillar there, or the other tool that you were developing at the same time, which is the actual universal brain architecture that you're going to hopefully be basing that AGI on and then taking to school.
So again, the main thing here is the gradual learning. And if I have to say something more, it's about, I could compare it to neural networks that can grow as they are gaining, grow and reconfigure as they are gaining new and new knowledge or skills. But to think about this as just neural networks will be, again, too limiting. But it's a network. That's probably the better description. And this kind of network is receiving error from the teacher. In the beginning, it's just very simple error channel, because the AI doesn't have skills to understand more complex error signal. Like, for example, if I just tell you reward or punishment, that's something that even really a basic agent can understand if he's biased to understand something like this. On the other side, if I tell to this a stupid or simple agent that don't do this because this will happen to you and please do it this way, if the agent doesn't have skills to understand what I just said, you know, it doesn't make sense to tell him this thing. So first, this kind of architecture needs to learn skills for better error signal or error feedback. And so again, and this network grows and reconfigures and is also in some kind of meta learning way, learning how to learn in a better way or more efficient way, or way that is actually making it better at adapting to solve new problems, or better at it's adapting to be better at adapting, and so on, you know, like these meta levels. And so maybe one of the descriptions of one of the architectures, because we have few of them in our team, but one of them, I would say, like gradual and guided meta learning. And start with very simple learning algorithms, something similar to evolution, but through this guiding, get it to learn learning algorithms very fast, and then use those to gain new architecture properties, new learning algorithms, and new practical skills. And this thing would be or is represented in some kind of growing network of nodes. And that's it. And yeah, we are working on this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I suggest people also check out your website, because you are using a diversity of approaches, which speaks to how sort of unbiased and agnostic you are. And you're just kind of aiming to get anything that works. And perhaps at some point you might even combine a number of those approaches, just like the team behind Watson had to do to make Watson win Jeopardy, for example. But let me talk to you a little bit about the theory of intelligence here, because I've interviewed both Dr. Chomsky and Dr. Minsky, and they both denied to me that we have made any progress whatsoever with respect to artificial general intelligence whatsoever. And one of the main things that they put to support that claim is the lack of a theory of intelligence. Noam Chomsky said we're eons away from that, for example, and you know, maybe you wouldn't be surprised from Noam Chomsky, but Marvin Minsky, I was lucky to interview him, probably one of the last interviews before he unfortunately passed away. And he said we have not gotten any closer to that. So how important is a theory of intelligence in your view? And how far or close are you to developing one yourself?
I think it's very important, because if you want to build something, some system, you know, a game or AI, you need to understand the theory, because it allows you to understand the general principles instead of the specifics. And therefore, you can kind of like compress the search for the solution, because you don't need to be solving all the specifics. You just need to solve the general principle that's behind all these very specific things. So I think theory is very important, and I'm not claiming that we have a theory of intelligence or something like this, but I think that like we understand something, and now we are testing the hypothesis, and we are testing them by implementing one minimum viable prototype after another, and getting a better and better picture about what is intelligence. And again, I think it goes hand in hand.
Do you have a theoretical part of the team that looks at that per se, or?
Everyone is actually doing this because I think it's very connected. It's like you need to understand the theory and you need to be building that thing, because it's like someone, and you will probably know the name, said that if I cannot build it, I don't understand it.
Yeah.
And so I think it's very much connected. And this actually is something similar to like that I learned when I was developing computer graphics and games and all these things, that you need to understand the theory and then you need to build it. And you iterate on this, you know, in this kind of cycle. And when you build it, your theory gets better. And with better theory, you can build a better thing. And it just goes in this circle. And
I see. So let's talk a little bit about the impetus behind the guest blog article that you wrote for singularityweblog.com, which is the general AI challenge. So share with us the specifics, the motivation, the milestones, the rewards, the challenges that you basically sent out there to the community, globally speaking. And of course, you back it up by a $5 million fund. So how is that whole process going to unfold, or how have you planned it to unfold?
So the main idea behind this is that we can either solve the general AI in our team, or someone from the wider community can solve it. And I don't think you need to be a scientist or a professor or, you know, person like this to actually build it, because I have seen it many times in a gaming and computer graphics industry that the people who are actually pushing it are not only the professors, but actually guys who understand the theory or can really compress the theory into something that is that works, you know, some approximations. Someone can say like some simple hacks or something like this, but they just like take what is relevant, what is most important, and build something, some really smart computer rendering algorithm or something like this, and make it working. So I think that there can be even like a normal people, you would say, not professional scientists, who can build something. And we want to get these people involved in general AI development much more through this challenge. And so the challenge is planned for many years. I mean, to be honest, I don't know how many years, basically until we will have general AI. And I hope that we will, at the end of the challenge, that we'll actually have the general AI.
So what are the first steps, though? What are the first milestones, benchmarks, the first releases of funding that you plan to basically give away to the people who win those first steps?
So the first round that we started a couple of weeks ago has $50,000 in the prizes, and focusing on gradual learning. And we released a set of training tasks which have this graduality in them, which means that one task is building on the previous task. So what agent learns in task one can be somehow reused or exploited in task number two. So if the agent learned to solve task number one, it will be much easier for him to solve task number two, instead of if the agent would start just with task number two and skip task number one. And it goes gradually like this up to the task number 40. And so for example,
so it's cumulative learning, basically.
It's cumulative, and because when you are in task 40, which is very complex, you can, as an agent, you can generate so many hypotheses that could be the solution to the task, that the space of this hypothesis is so huge that without having the biases that you acquire in the previous tasks, it's just impractically huge. You know, you will not be able to search that space. And also you will not be able to state hypotheses that will actually help you solve task number 40. So basically, another way how to think about this, and I think it's practical way how to think about intelligence, is that you are building biases, positive biases, not just like the cognitive biases, like this negative thing, but positive biases that helps you to narrow the search space or to make it more wider, or actually to generate the right hypotheses, to search through this space, to search through more plausible areas in this hypothesis space, and so on. And you will learn this, or the agent will learn this in these tasks. And as it is progressing in more and more, like, or additional tasks, it's already pre-biased to solve the following task much more efficiently than if it just goes straight to that very complex, let's say, task number 40. So this first round that we launched 2 weeks ago has 50,000 in prizes, is focusing on gradual learning. And there are actually two set of prizes. One is quantitative, the other is qualitative. Quantitative is about an agent that can then finish all the tasks in the shortest number of time steps, and will also pass the graduality and not forgetting validation test. And I will get to this later. And then there is qualitative prize, and this qualitative prize is that people don't need to send the agents. They can just, you know, like, show us some idea or some concept, and there will be a judge, there will be a jury, and this jury will say, like, okay, this concept or this idea, this design is best thing for us. And back to this quantitative prize, so we will be also measuring, like, the agent that will solve all the evaluation tasks in the shortest number of time steps can win, but we'll also test if the agent is actually using gradual learning. So we will compare the same agent that will start on task number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on, with the same agent that didn't have these tasks and just started with, let's say, task number 10. And then the agent that had the previous experience on this, like, preliminary tasks should solve it in a shorter number of time steps than the agent that didn't have this previous experience. And this is kind of like not a proof, this is very important, but it's an indication that there was some gradual learning in the process, because sometimes it can actually, the gradual learning can work against you. But this is probably too many details. And then also not forgetting. So, for example, as the agent is learning new skills, we also don't want him to forget the skills that the agent learned on the previous skills. But again, this also does need to apply sometimes, because sometimes you actually, if you want to learn some, like, advanced task, you need to forget some of your previous beliefs. So sometimes you need to change it. And the question is, if we design the tasks in a way that actually forgetting is useful or not useful. And maybe last important information is that this round will be running for 6 months. And then there will be 1 month evaluation where we will be evaluating the agents. And we released training tasks that people can use to train their agents and also see if there is actually some gradual learning. But the actual evaluation will be happening, or we will do it on non-public evaluation tasks, which will be kind of similar to the training task, but still different. And the people the participants, they will send to us pre-trained agents. So they will not just send the code, but they will also send agents that were already trained on the training tasks, or maybe even different curricula that, you know, the participant created for his agent. And we will evaluate these pre-trained agents on the evaluation non-public tasks, and then we will announce the winners.
Fascinating. Fantastic details. I think this was very useful, especially for people who are considering taking part in this challenge. Now, let's talk a little bit about, you mentioned that AGI may take many years, and you talked about measurements on the first round. But how do you know that you've succeeded ultimately at creating AGI?
This is a good question. I think we will need to have, like, part of the curriculum. We actually call it School for AI. So part of this School for AI will need to be also some evaluations. And if evaluation, so we can actually measure if the agent learned some learning task up to acceptable performance, and so that we can let him go to the following task and so on. And somewhere there will need to be evaluations for all these skills that it will learn. And I think it will be something much more complex than just Turing test or something like this, because we will need
Marvin Minsky said that the Turing test is a joke on my interview with him.
I think basically it's a joke. So I think it can be just one of the like subtests or something like this, but it will not be enough. And actually, I think we will need much more targeted tests for all these skills that human level intelligence needs. And only there we will be able to say with some certainty that, okay, this is human level intelligence or this is not human level intelligence.
Okay. And then you need another test, don't you? Because first is to establish the fact or deny the fact, to falsify the hypothesis that you have reached AGI. But then we need the good test to know whether it's actually good or bad AGI. So how do we test for that? Because we can have AGI that's not necessarily good and that can do awful damage, right? So how do we test for that? And that's the tricky part for me.
Yeah, this is tricky part. Again, I think right now I don't have answer that will be enough at the end, you know, of our journey. But my current idea about this is that we will have, again, some, let's say, ethical or moral tests. And the AI should not know it's being tested, and we'll test it in different situations and we'll see how it behaves. And this would be like a very simple answer, but it also have many problems or many special cases where it will not work. So, for example, one of the things that we actually, and I didn't talk about this yet, is that I wouldn't actually, or I don't really want to create AI like completely autonomous agent and then let it go freely to the world. I would actually rather create AI that is just a tool for people, something that can help you solve some problems, even very complex problems, but can help you solve problems. And then it's up to you to actually make the final call. So maybe in the beginning, the AI can be just like an advisor. So for example, instead of having the AI design factories for new AIs and all these things, maybe just have an AI that will propose a new blueprint for factory. And then you will double check, you know, if everything is correct or something like this.
Mm-hmm. It's a version of what people have sometimes referred to as the Oracle AI. And then there's different sort of levels of control over the Oracle. So you have the extreme level of control where some people have proposed entire sandboxing of the AI, where you have only a single bit leaving the sandbox with a zero or one, meaning yes or no kind of questions and answers. And then others who give it a lot more freedom, with the example that you suggested, for example, of giving you a whole design for a factory or whatever it may be, where you kind of have a lot higher confidence that it's not going to backfire or be detrimental to humanity in general overall. Yeah, but to some people and to me personally, that sounds similar to the control over our children, for example, right? When you have a child, you don't have a guarantee that that child is not going to become a Hitler one day. You hope that it wouldn't become a Hitler, and to improve that hope, you teach it in the best way possible, just like you mentioned with your school of AI. We have, of course, schools for children, and you want to give it good mentorship and tell the child to read certain kinds of good books. And but ultimately, I don't think there's perfect guarantee, just like as you pointed out. Ultimately, our children are free agents of their own, and we cannot control their fate, their destiny, or their decision-making process. We can only guide them, but it's up to them at some point, right? Which is why, for example, AI has sometimes been called our mind children, and so on. And that's, of course, the control problem. Now, let me talk about another thing that you mentioned in one of your previous speeches that I watched yesterday, where you said that everybody will benefit from AI and AGI. So unpack a little bit that claim for us, please.
The AI or superintelligence or general AI will give us, you know, means to exploit the universe in a much more efficient way than we are doing right now. So there will be some kind of abundance of everything. And there still will be some resource constraints unless, you know, we discover some new physical law or something like that. But I think there will be, but for the needs of humans, it will be more than enough. So everyone will have his physical needs satisfied. And of course, if the AI will be created by good people or people who want to share this kind of wealth with the others. And so, yeah, this is the answer.
I agree with you entirely, but I think that it's one of the possibilities, and right now it's kind of unclear which way we're heading, perhaps, because if you talk to somebody in northern Pennsylvania where they close all the coal mines, and or in the sort of the rust belt in the United States where all the kind of steel mills and other huge plants where people had made very good living for decades, if not for 100 or more years, you know, they would say that automation, and that's where my concern comes in, that automation in the short to medium term creates what some people have already referred to as technological unemployment, or at least a rise of unemployment. And then consequently, you have a political backlash to people who have lost their job and are basically struggling to survive. And, you know, it's not hard to see that most recently we had the Brexit in the United Kingdom, and now we had the election of Donald Trump in the United States, mostly from people who have not benefited from the explosion of technological advances that we have experienced in our civilization in the last 10 or 20 years. In other words, we have had the greatest progress in terms of technology ever for the last 15 or 20 years, and yet so many people from the middle class have gone to poverty line. And therefore, you have the political backlash, and therefore, you have an environment which can basically ruin all the progress that we have created so far. So what do you think about those trends, and how do we mitigate them?
Yeah, I think that if this technological unemployment will create or will, like, there will be a chance that it will create some kind of backlash or some kind of, like, riots.
Just like Ned Ludd's people were breaking down the spinning jennies at the beginning of the Industrial Revolution.
Yeah. Or this is about just human mentality or their emotions and everything. So if people who lost their jobs don't have money, if they will feel that the rich people are taking something from them, then it's something that has to be solved. And what I see in even like politicians, at least they are discussing this kind of risk and discussing some possible like solutions, like, you know, universal basic income or taxation of robots and all these things. And I don't know which one is the best answer for the short term or long term. Also, it's like, I don't really know, because I will not be the person who will decide on this, you know, like, I'm not a politician and so on. So, but I think they will choose one of these. It's just like, if the country or the state has some problems, the politicians should find some solution. It's not always the best one, but again, I think we'll solve this somehow.
But the reason why I'm asking you is because you, someone might say, may be kind of causing the problem by inventing smarter and smarter artificial intelligence, which can get applied everywhere, basically, around us, right? That's the whole goal, right? So, for example, there's 4 million truck drivers in the United States. What happens to them? And, you know, truck driver in the United States, those people make between $80,000 or $120,000, right? So chances are their jobs are gone. And there's another 5 million jobs like post mail delivery and all those. Those are all going to be gone in the next 2, 3, 5 years at the most or something, right? What do we do with all those people and how do we keep them, you know, not rebelling and revolting? And you know, because people would say when you're releasing or creating a technology, you do bear some responsibility for its application and its consequences.
Yeah. Yeah. So since the governments have the responsibility to make sure that the people in their country have some good living conditions and so on, I think the governments will take some steps to solve this. One of them can be just like taxing the companies that are creating this kind of automation and basically causing the loss of the jobs. And or it will be mandatory, or it will be like forced, or it will be, maybe there will be some form of altruism, but I don't think there will be too much altruism on the side of the companies in the short term, because it's like if you create AI and everyone will start using the AI cars and 4 million people will lose their jobs, then I cannot see a company that will just give away the money back to the drivers or something like this. It's just like the business doesn't, or capitalism doesn't work this way. But again, the government can basically force the company to actually give some of that money back to the people. I'm not saying it's right or not, but it could be one of the solution. And
Bill Gates is, for example, proposing something along the lines you're talking about by taxing the robots or the AI or something that replaces the labor, that's in the same rate of taxation that the labor was previously taxed at.
Like I'm not a fan of like socialism or, you know, like this kind of thing, but I think it can be like pragmatical solution for a short-term problems, because these people, they will need the money, they will need to live somehow. And if the people who own the AI want to live on this planet without, you know, like worrying that the masses will kill you next day or something like this, then they will need to give something back. And that's it. I think you can look on this like a pure pragmatical problem.
Yeah, my concern is that, you know, not that the machines would rise one day. My concern is that poor people who have lost everything would rise up way before that and destroy the system that can produce further progress in the short to medium term, so we can't actually have the chance to get to the long term. That's my concern, personally. But Marek, there's only about 7 or 8 minutes left of our conversation. So let me just ask you a few things at a kind of faster pace, if I may. So first of all, if I were to put you on the spot and ask you to make an educated guess about the timeline to the technological singularity, whereabouts do you fall?
I don't know, because like all these predictions are based on our own biases, beliefs, and you like the thing that you said. I'm thinking, or my perspective on this is from different angle. It's like, let's make it as soon as possible, but of course safely. And so we put a deadline clock in our office, and it is nine years and I don't know, like 8 months. And again, it's one of the like methods how to push ourselves a little bit more. But again, it's not a prediction. It's more like how to push ourselves. And
what's the biggest challenge that you think you're facing then? If you don't want to commit yourself to a timeline, what's the biggest challenge that we're facing to get there in your view?
It's that the human level skill set can be actually very many skills, and it can be quite even like a lot of work, detailed work to put it together. So it's like, I think what we need to solve is this gradual learning. It's, let's call it like algorithmic problem. And let's say that it's not the biggest issue, but even if you will have this gradual learning thing, I think it will still be a lot of work to create the learning tasks for the AI so that we can teach it and bias it in a very safe way. It's just like, maybe this is not a good analogy, but if you're a man, how easy is to make a baby, you know, and then how much work is to actually train it
yeah.
and let let it be like a good human. So maybe something like this. And I think
I think it's a great example because the hard work is afterwards.
Exactly. And so I think that here we may be much more surprised with the complexity of the human level skill set or the repertoire of human skills than what we think right now. And so this I think can be surprising. And
finish up. Yeah.
So maybe the timeline, I would say, if someone gets a little bit lucky and really finds some really good shortcuts or something like this, maybe he can do it in 3 years, but maybe it will take 30 years. So
3 to 30 years.
Yeah.
Okay. That's a good range. Okay. I kind of feel the same way, by the way. I feel exactly the same.
Yeah. So again, I think I cannot predict this. It's more like, let's make it as soon as possible, because the scenarios with good AGI are much better than the scenarios without. And but I don't know really exactly when.
Okay, so we're kind of running in the last 3 or 4 minutes here. So let me ask you this. What's the best place to find more about Marek Rosa personally or the work of GoodAI generally?
So I'm posting something on my blog post occasionally, but I think the better source of what we are doing would be a GoodAI website, like www.goodai.com. And there is some information about some theory of intelligence that we have, some framework, roadmaps, and the AI Roadmap Institute, where we are studying the roadmaps, comparing them. There is also a link to the general AI challenge and so on.
Yeah, it's a fantastic resource with lots of links and specific details that people can dive into, just like I did yesterday and the day before. Okay, so the final question that I always ask of all my guests on my show is, what's the most important thing? You know, we talked to you today for probably about 80-85 minutes. What's the single most important message that you want us to take away from this conversation with Marek Rosa today?
Mm-hmm. That's an interesting question. Maybe that we are working on general AI and the singularity and the future of humanity and these things, and please wish us good luck.
Fantastic. Yeah, I do wish you good luck. And actually, I would suggest and perhaps add to that we should all kind of monitor, cheer for you, and help if we can with your work. Because what I like about your project is that it's explicitly good AI. Yeah. Because there's lots of projects that are AI. And I'm very concerned about those, to be honest with you, especially the ones that are funded by organizations like DARPA, or even ones that are even much more secret than that and usually funded by military money. So I honestly hope you guys succeed first, so you have the first mover advantage rather than someone working at a military lab, top secret and usually designed to kill in one way or another. So that's kind of my 2 cents and why I prefer to cheer for you than anyone else out there, because I think that's the crucial difference that may make a difference not only for us individual or for you as a company, but for our civilization in general. In fact, that's how important I think it is. All right. So Marek Rosa, thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you, Nicola. Thank you and goodbye.
If you guys enjoyed this show, you can help me make it better in a couple of ways. You can go and write a review on iTunes, or you can simply make a donation.